system manager even faster than the other things you were going to do.
But I can do number one. Maybe I want that to be one of my...
Well, if that's one of your things, then...
I can beat us in every few seconds.
Whatever. Beat the shit out of you is one of my units.
Then you lose an orchestra member.
Okay. So, red room. Silence, please. And then let's begin. I don't think you're in the camera at all, staying where you are. Now your shoulder is showing a little bit.
Yeah, I kept looking down.
Let's see. I'm going to try to bring it down just a little bit. Okay. Now, if you stay right about here, it's... Then you're in between the two people.
Okay.
Okay. I thought that your first unit was this. Right. But then, did you try to play it another time and have it screw up?
I think I screwed that up, yeah. Okay. I think I forgot that I couldn't play it right next to each other.
Okay. Then I got confused because I really wasn't sure what you were doing anymore. Your thing is fairly straight. I immediately got lost. I wasn't sure whether you were doing the belly thing and a chest loop or whether you were doing something else or whatever. I was completely lost. I think part of it was that I didn't look at you quickly enough.
Yeah.
I had to get into the habit of looking at you the whole time or whatever, whereas I'm looking at the keys and, you know, whatever. So I probably would have been less lost if I just been looking at you. You want to try it one more time and then move on to something else? Okay, now every time you do this, you have to do something different.
Mm-hmm.
That's a part of the challenge. Okay, so let's go. Mm-hmm. Problematic it is. That was a lot better though, I thought.
Yeah.
Because for one thing, you did a really pronounced hip thing, so that was easy for me to follow, and then you did a more pronounced shoulder thing, right? So that was easy for me to follow. And then you obviously had the spritzing into the mouthpiece type thing, which was easy to follow, and the slide thing, that was easy to follow. You, however, confused me because I thought that there were some times when I did like this, and you did a kind of similar thing, like that or whatever, immediately after me, and then I couldn't tell whether you did that maybe three times immediately after me, whether there were differences in the relationships, because one of the times I was doing it simultaneously with Margaret doing a hip thing, I think.
No, it changed because, like, I went around and did, like, something based on each of what you were doing, and then I started going back through and doing it in a different sequence.
Okay.
But sometimes you did the thing.
Okay, well, we got that set. Let's move on to persisting and resisting. This one's easier, but did you have fun doing that?
Yes, Mr.
Chen. Okay, thank you, Miss Allie. Persisting and resisting. Play in accordance with the system without telling the other players what the system is. If you make a mistake, either stop playing and stay stopped until everyone else is done, or play according to a second system for a satisfactory length of time. What constitutes satisfactory is determined by your own criteria. Then return to the first system unless you make a mistake during the second system, in which case a third system is to be followed for a satisfactory length of time, after which the second system is reverted to unless, etc., etc. From each system, one either moves one system forward or one backward, except in the case of the first system, of course, where you can't go backwards. If a player thinks another player has stopped, they can end, but they cannot restart, even if they're wrong about the other player stopping. So somebody can fake you out. Like Margaret's system, third system could be to stay really still, in which case I might think that she's done, so I might look at it and think, okay, Margaret's done, I'm going to stop now, and I might stop, and then she might start dancing again, in which case I'm fucked because I'm out of it for the rest of it.
Sorry, could you read that again?
You want to, really?
I could read it on my own if you want to pass it to me. I just want
it's
to
right
read
there.
It. God damn.
Second one. Basically, you play a system. So let's say that my system was to go like. So, not that I need to explain to you what that is, but you can hear it. And then I just kept doing that.
Got it.
But then let's say I went too far down or fumbled the note or something. Then I would have made a mistake. Then I have to go into a second system. My second system might be. The second system too complex to remember even what it was, so therefore I made it my life difficult because okay then I could decide all right that's satisfactory length of time, I'll go back to the first thing. So fine, but then if I make a mistake again, I can't move on to that second system again because I don't remember what it is. So I'm basically stuck with stopping. Right now, if I had made a mistake in the first system and I'd made a system like this for myself, system, which might be... And then let's say I play that for a satisfactory amount of time, then I could go back to the... is that you start getting into memory problems right away, which is partially what this is meant to help with, increasing memory. If you make a mistake in the first system and you move on to the second system, then you have to remember the second system either when you go back to the first system or when you go on to the third system. You have to remember every system that you make so that you can have the flexibility to keep moving around, or you're stuck, in which case you have to stop. Is that simple enough? In this one, we don't have to pay attention to each other, except to if we decide that we want to stop based on somebody else's stopping. Does that make sense, Margaret? Or do you want me to go over it again? You're looking. You're rereading.
Yeah, I was reading. So you only move around if you make a mistake.
Or if you're. If you make your first system, let's say your first system is a particular dance move, okay, and then you kind of start to get carried away and you break another particular dance move and you're like, fuck, I was only supposed to stay within the realm with this particular type of dance move. Then you decide that's a mistake. So then you think, okay, my second system is this other dance move. You move on to the second system. You do that for an indeterminate length. Long enough for you to feel like you've done it correctly and you've gotten out of it wherever you want to, then you can go back to your first system.
Okay.
However, if you fuck up the second system,
you have to
remember what the second system is and move forward to the third system. The thing is that if your memory is bad, you'll end up going through system after system after system after system
and
never being
able
to go back because you can't remember what you did before. Which is fine, but can get really frustrating. Any of it can.
Is this supposed to illustrate that phrase, you can go home, but you can never go back?
I thought it was you can never go back home again.
Yes, sort of.
That's a different saying.
You can go home, but you can never... You can go back, but you can never go home? You can go home, but you can never go back, right?
I think that's right.
Let's play number two, persisting, resisting.
Wait, one more question.
Yeah.
Can your system, like the examples you were giving were, like, very, like, okay, like, these chords?
It can be anything,
okay.
Yeah. I give simple examples because it's easier to follow. You know, I mean, I might decide to do something like play the most complex progression on the keyboard that I can manage to pull off or whatever, but then I have to remember. And since I'm trying to make these things up every time, I usually stick with the simple stuff. So, yeah, then we're stopped whenever we all decide that it's over or whatever. I mean, but don't stop because someone else stops necessarily. If you're still playing, you keep going. If you stop because someone else has stopped, that's one way of stopping, but it's not the only way of stopping. You understand? In other words, we don't all have to stop at the same time. I might drop out early because I fucked up, and you can keep going for another 5 minutes.
Okay,
let's go. Let's hit it.
Thank you.
Brings up a rule that's not on the sheets. Turn off your cell phone.
That was the first time I got yelled at for that.
Alright, well, I thought that went pretty good.
I got confused at one point.
Yeah, I noticed you dropped out for a long time.
Well, I dropped out for a long time.
I was gonna base changing off of one note on you playing something and you wouldn't start, and I was just like, oh man.
Well, I decided to make one of my things not play. But then there was the rule about stopping and not restarting, and I wasn't sure if I was like then.
No, you can have
a pause where you wait for something to happen.
Yeah.
Only you know what's stopping.
But I was happy with that. I thought it was interesting. I thought that the combination of the instrument tonalities and your dancing was an interesting combination.
I turned it off.
Let's try the octave butler. The name of which, of course, is a takeoff on Octavia Butler, the recently deceased sci-fi writer.
She died?
Yeah, I think last year, maybe. When?
Dead ski.
Yeah.
I didn't know Octavia Butler died.
Play in accordance with a system staying within one octave. Again, an octave is being a musical term. It doesn't have to be an octave. It can be a sort of conceptual register. Switch to a different octave every time you make a mistake, eliminating every octave that you make a mistake in. Stop when you feel like it or when you played all octaves available to you. If octaves aren't applicable to your sound producing situation, use an alternate limitation you consider to be analogous. Easy way for a dancer to apply the idea of octaves is to move up or down throughout the body, the feet first, you know, whatever. Doesn't have to be that way. And you don't necessarily have to go from lower to higher. Then I'm only going to move my hips, then I'm only going to move my elbows, you know, something like that. As long as you have like a somewhat strict hierarchy of things that you're declaring octaves. You probably only have like three, four octaves.
Four.
Yeah. have four octaves.
At least that I can reach.
You have three octaves. I have whatever, seven, I can remember. Two, three, four, five, six, seven octaves. So, that means that I will probably be the last person playing, unless I deliberately do things to make it so hard for myself that I make mistakes really quickly, which I'll sometimes do, so that I can try to move through it faster than everybody else does. I've played these enough times now so that I'm already starting to run out of ideas of what I can do with an octave, which doesn't say much for my imagination here. At any rate, this one's pretty simple. Any questions before we try?
So just keep playing in that octave.
Whatever
system.
But you create a system. So let's say my system were to go.
No,
it could be anything. It doesn't even. I play pitch based things on this just because I don't have as much timbre possibility as you do, for example. You know, so you could choose a system where you had three different mouth sounds you made into the trombone as one system within an octave or whatever. The thing is that if you make a mistake, then you move out of that octave and you never go back again.
And what's okay? You just determine what a mistake is.
Well, yeah, you know, if I decided that I was going to play this, if I decided that that was my system, that particular melody, and I played it wrong, then I made a mistake and I could never play in that octave again. So, for me, the easy way to do it is to start at the lower octave and move all the way up, or start at the higher octave and move all the way down. I don't usually do it that way, but then I have to remember, okay, I played the middle C octave. I can't play that octave again once I fucked it up. And then I also have to make the systems hard enough so that I'll make a mistake. This is another problem. Sometimes people will choose a system like I'm just going to go. Well, you're going to find that you're going to have a very hard time making a mistake playing that unless you start thinking of it in more and more specific terms, like, okay, I have to count 1001, 1002, 1003, 1004, you know, to determine whether I'm playing at the right pace or whatever. Something. So you have to mentally complicate it for yourself if you start out with something too simple, or you're going to be stuck there, and it's not over until everybody goes through all their octaves.
But you can stop whenever you want.
Mm-mm, not
it
with this one.
It says stop when you feel like it.
Not under octave butler.
It says stop.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, you're right. Stop when you feel like it or when you play all octaves. Sorry, you're right. You're right.
You just lost your systems manager
on
job.
I'm the systems uber manager. I can't lose my job. Okay. So you're right, stop when you feel like it or when you play along with the ability. Alright, are we ready?
Thank you.
house.
Actually, it sounds like you already improved just over the course of the practice. Because you were playing those higher notes reasonably well.
And then, yeah, those high ones were really difficult. And then
yeah.
That was when I, like, did the final fuck up. And I'm just like, all right, I can't, like, keep that one going. That actually, like, physically hurts after a while. I'm like, oh.
Well, that, yeah. I stopped without playing the last octave because I decided to take advantage of the stop when you feel like it clause, which I've never done before, thanks to Alan. Alright. So, have we got that pretty much under control? Alright.
More or less. That was... Feeling it.
Alright. Number four. Reed players for Johann Nystrom. Johann's one of the other members of this group. The first time he came here, he brought this score, which is basically kind of like a sound poetry score with a bunch of letters on it and some words interspersed, etc. And we did it, and he asked us whether we liked it, and we said it was fine, but basically it's like translating any visual thing in front of you. So then I thought of having these hats that would have frames in front of them, and you would look through the frame, and you'd look around, and you would just interpret anything within the frame as a score, which I thought was pretty entertaining. But the easier version of it is to just look at another player and use them as a score. And the way you use another person as a score, or a player as a score, is up to you, but conventional graphic notation works generally by translating visuals in the same way that you would translate the visuals of a conventional score, so or a similar way, a related way. So, like, you could choose to either read the score, like if Margaret were standing up and I were reading her as a score, I could either choose to read her from left to right, top to bottom, and I could make interpretations of things like color, shading, motion, lines, whatever. A simple thing to do is to just sort of draw the person with your hands, which I can do on the piano. So, like, if I were going like this, then I might take her head and I go like, and then go like this. So it would be like, you know, going across her shoulders. And then if she were moving her arms, I might go, you know, like if her arms are going like this or whatever, I might do something like that. I might, and I use these same examples all the time, but give her two eyeballs and two nostrils and a mouth. I might give her some hair. I might give her an ear, two ears, whatever, by cupping my hand like this, etc., etc. So how you interpret the player that you're looking at as a score is up to you. Let's say they're wearing a t-shirt that has a number on it. You can interpret those numbers as notes or whatever, you know, or you can interpret darkness as really dense things and lightness as, you know, something else a little bit more sparse, etc., etc. The gist of it is that I'll probably be looking at Margaret because she's dead ahead of me. Allie will either be looking at me or at Margaret probably because we're more dead ahead with her, and then you would either be looking at any of us because you have more options available to you. You only choose one player to play as a score. And then things happen that sort of become feedback loops, which is one of the interesting parts of it. Like, let's say that Allie decided to use me as her score, and I started going, and Margaret was, whatever, moving her arms in a certain way, and I decided to sort of quasi-simulate the motion of her hands or her arms or whatever. And Allie might choose to read me as a score by imitating my hands, which means that I'd be imitating Margaret, closer, and then you might be looking at me, but looking at me from a side view, so you might interpret it in a different way or whatever. So, Kenny was playing bass clarinet over here one time. He was standing right in front of me, so I was imitating his hand motions. He was imitating me, so we got caught in this loop of imitating each other. And then I decided that if Kenny made a mistake, that would be what would cause me to break out of the loop, and that would end my portrait. So, those are some of the possibilities. This is a pretty easy. Try it? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I'm ready whenever you are.
Sorry.
You did that.
question is, were you reading anyone else as a score?
Yeah.
Okay, what, you were listening to somebody and reading them as a score?
Figure out.
Okay.
I'm watching from my peripheral vision.
Okay. What do you think?
That was cool.
That was the funnest one?
Yeah. It allowed, there was a lot of freedom in
MFL. Yeah, well, watching you dance was actually really interesting for me, because that was the most I paid attention to you dancing so far, and it was also, it seemed to me, the most expressive dancing that you were doing, so it gave me a lot more leeway to be more expressive myself. So I thought there was a lot of nice interplay going on there that wasn't necessarily based around obvious musical things, but more like peripheral things that became obvious as they coalesced. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Sense?
I was trying to change my octave depending on which level she was playing on, and then also trying to like play something different when you're resting, like when you're like thinking about what to play next. I was trying to play something in there, and as soon as you went to hit, I would stop. So,
so your portrait was more like a negative portrait over that.
I guess so.
I don't mean negative in the critical sense. Alright, so let's move on to birds. Choose one or more short phrases that you'll play throughout the entire session. These phrases, once chosen, can only change in a very subtle theme and variation way. For example, your phrase might be too-wee, which you can then repeat in fairly quick succession as too-wee, 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 or as too-wee, too-wee, too. There should always be a longer pause between the playing of the phrases than the length of the playing of the phrases itself. So, if playing the phrases takes 2 seconds, there should be a pause longer than 2 seconds between them, preferably at least 4 seconds. The phrases can be much more complicated if and only if, the player can remember them and not make mistakes. If mistakes are made, it's not a disaster. The player should just then try their best to minimize the mistakes in the future by simplifying the phrase vocabulary and sequence. Here's an example of a more complex possibility. Weep, 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 we leap, quack, which could then be varied as weep, 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 quap, and or weep, 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 we leap, quap, etc. This system, once activated, is in effect throughout the entire session. It's part of a meta system, and a player's bird song should be periodically inserted into whatever other system is being played, independent of the rules of that other system. So, let's say that everyone's just played birds and then moved on to Red Room. Independent of Red Room's 2-unit restriction, the player's bird song can be inserted from time to time or not at the player's discretion. Players can also be mockingbirds or lyrebirds by creating their songs from imitations of their environments. This, however, is an extremely difficult process that should only be attempted by advanced players sure of their abilities. For example, advanced mockingbird player 1 might hear player 2, who's performing birds, go too-wee, too-wee, too, but might hear player 4, who's performing persistent resisting by playing in a system like only notes in a C major chord with an occasional non-pitched disruption. Then player 1 can mock them by playing too-wee, too-wee, too, followed immediately by only notes in a C major chord with an occasional non-pitched disruption. However, this then becomes their birdsong and must be stuck to in exactly the same sequence throughout the session. More mockings can be added to the sequence, but the order of the sequence must be adhered to, and only minor variations can take place within the overall sequence. So, does that make sense? Basically, it boils down to, you make a birdsong, it's pretty simple, and you repeat it with long pauses between what's subtle theme variations, like I could go. Et cetera, et cetera. We won't get into the meta system aspect of it yet. So for the moment, we're just playing this just for the sake of inventing a bird song and then sticking with it. So, is that clear? Okay. Is that clear, Margaret?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Let's go then.
Ready?
Nothing will be in 4/4. Ever again. Thank you. simple enough. It's then playing the actual context of trying to remember it all where it becomes a little bit trickier, or if you decide to be a Mockingbird. The only criticism I might have is that your theme of variations seem to be a little bit broad. You're free to disagree with me.
Dealing with two keys and changing up a little bit each time, and I thought that's what you meant by that we could vary within a phrase. So I came up with so I just like picked two notes to work with and then tried to switch it up in a bunch of different ways.
Okay, well maybe it was less dramatic than it seemed like to me.
I mean, maybe I should have made it more complex. I want to do it right.
Well, it's obviously based on what birds actually do. And birds usually have a particular sequence that they do things in.
Sure, so I was thinking of these two sounds, which could be two notes,
yeah.
And how they just, like, mix those up a whole bunch.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay, well then I was probably,
Maybe I had, like, not such a great grasp on the exact, super exact way that you wanted this, and thought more of, like, how birds sound and like what.
Well then, no, you were probably fine. It was probably just that I heard it. I thought that there were times when you stepped outside of the two notes, for example. So you didn't step outside of the
two
notes.
Oh, no, I didn't.
Yeah, okay. All right. Then
No. I'm adhering to the higher power, which is birds.
Okay. So let's move on to cheaper imitation, which is one of the movie states.
Duck.
I have a protocol in there, if you want to make it really easy for yourself. Cheaper imitation, that's number 7. We're skipping over number 6 for the moment because that's a meta system which we might not have time to get to today. Speaking of time, it's 8:30, so we're not doing so much actually.
I wish I had thought of this vibraphone before I ran home and got my freaking violin.
Is anyone else playing?
Well, not in this particular group, but in other groups, yeah.
Yeah.
They are?
Mm-hmm.
Am I gonna have to compete when orchestra time rolls around?
When orchestra time comes around, there will probably be enough instruments to go around so that we won't have to worry about it. We'll try to work that out in advance. There won't be an actual orchestra rehearsal of everybody together for probably at least another couple of months. I haven't even met half the people yet.
Who have you even met, though?
No, I don't even... It's all people that I've solicited through emails. So, okay, like right now I've practiced with, including you all, 14 people out of the 30 people that agreed to do it over 6 practices. So it's going to take the rest of the month to get through everybody, probably. But anyway, cheaper imitation. Each player may imitate another or not. If a player believes they are being successfully imitated, they must either stop entirely, initiate a new idea, or continue with their current idea, but in a way that can no longer successfully imitated. Now, this has been rewritten since then, but this is an old printout here. For example, if player 1 chooses to play one note repeatedly instead of imitating another player, like let's say I were to go, and player 2, which could be Allie, then imitates that by playing one note repeatedly, then player 1 must decide if the imitation is successful. Now, she's got the right pitch now, or higher, but yeah, she's an octave. So then I would. This brings up the issue: is it necessary for player 2 to be playing the exact same pitch in order for the imitation to be successful? Well, I would say usually not by my standards, but you could make that decision. Or is just repeating any sound all that's needed? I would say in this case I would accept that as a successful imitation. If player 1 decides that the imitation is successful, then they follow the above instructions. So I would then either stop or change. play something that is in the same system, but that Ellie can no longer play correctly, which would be to take it outside of her octave range. And I would decide he was definitely not successful in imitating. But let's say I've decided that she was successful and that I was then gonna do something else. Or if I decided that she wasn't successful, I kept doing it, and that would challenge her to hone her imitation skills. I tried to find the right pitch, which she did eventually anyway. If a player believes the person they are imitating has changed direction because of the imitation, that player must stop, initiate a new idea, find another person to imitate. So let's say I decided that Allie successfully imitated me, and then I went. And she has to stop, or initiate a new idea, or find another person to imitate, but she can't imitate me anymore.
Really? I can't?
No.
But she can't imitate you because why?
Because that's just the way the system is set up. If I have changed what I've done because I know that she's imitating me.
Okay, then she can't imitate you.
And she can't imitate me anymore. She either has to start playing something for other people to imitate, stop altogether, or imitate somebody else. So she might choose at that point to imitate you. Mm-hmm. So
could she then go back to imitating you later?
Yes.
How soon?
That's a good question. How soon? I guess after you've gone through the whole process with him. Because like once you switch to imitating him, then he has to make the decision about whether you're imitating him correctly or not. And if he decides that you're imitating him correctly, then he can go through those things of either stopping, breaking out of it, or making it impossible for you to imitate it by playing, say, sliding notes or whatever. In which case, then you have to move on to something else. So you could then go back to imitating me. Once you stop, however, you're done.
So don't stop.
Well, eventually you would want to stop. Alright, so
also, Cheaper Imitation,
which is a reference to Cheap Imitation, which is a piece by John Cage that was an imitation of Eric Satie. So just so you know, there's the music history going on here. Okay, so is that clear? Clear? You know, the main thing is to just remember, either you start off imitating or you start off doing something which could hypothetically be imitated by somebody else. If nobody imitates you, like it says here, if a player initiates an idea and nobody chooses to imitate them, like if I were to play something like, and nobody were to imitate me, after a while, I would think, okay, I've been doing this for a long time, nobody's been imitating me, I either have to continue with that idea until somebody does imitate me, stop, which I'm done. So,
you can't change.
Right, I can't change. So, the thing about that example that I just gave is that the only person who could even begin to try to imitate it would be Allie. And the criteria, I could set the criteria high for how successful she was and say she's not successful at all because I'm playing chords. Of course, I could interpretively say that Margaret is imitating me successfully, but I probably wouldn't go that way. So I probably would choose something like that to start off with because I want to give myself more flexibility. So just remember, if somebody is imitating you, you have to go through some sort of change. If somebody that you're imitating goes through some sort of change, then you have to go through, then the imitator needs to go through some sort of change. That's it. Is that all clear?
But you can change from playing your own thing to imitating.
Right.
But you can't change from you playing your own thing to playing different your own thing.
You can if someone else imitates you.
Someone else imitates
you. And you decide that they're successful. Okay. Okay, are we ready?
Are you still on camera?
No. the same thing in a way that's not no longer imitatable by the other person. And as soon as they notice that you've switched because you've noticed that they're imitating you and have decided that they're imitating you correctly,
then they need to switch.
Then they have to switch. Okay?
If you stop, you can start again. Or no, you're done.
No, if you stop under any circumstance, then you're done.
Pressure.
And I'm just supposed to sort of abstractly.
Right. The abstract thing is where it gets complicated. Like, how are we going to imitate Margaret? You know?
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, you can take
Well, you could take her, like, map from above, like, movements as coordinates, and you can play those out.
Yeah, or, you know, I mean, you could, like, look at her hips, for example, and decide that when the one hip goes this far over, it's that note, and when it goes 2 inches over the other direction, that's this note, or whatever. And then you could apply that. She's going to have a hard time figuring out how we're imitating her. But if she notices a correlation between the rhythm, like if she was moving her hip from side to side, and I started going like... in coordination with her rhythm, then
yeah.
She'd probably figure out that I was imitating her. In fact, I'm going to try... Well, I'm not going to guarantee this, but I might try to imitate her just for the sake of seeing whether I can do it in a way where she'll recognize. Let's try. Once she catches on that you're imitating her, you have to either
imitate
it or you have to imitate somebody else.
Then I went to to my own thing.
Okay, so you went to your own thing.
I just started my own thing, yeah.
Okay, then that's fine. I started off doing my own thing, which was actually something like... it's more like this. Decided to imitate Margaret, so when she would move her hip out a little bit, very subtle movement. I was going trying to coordinate that to her hip, and then she brought her hand in. Your left hand. Then I wasn't sure whether you realized that I was trying to imitate you or not, but then you brought some, then you changed it, and I thought, okay, I can't do that anymore because she's caught on that I'm imitating. Did you realize that I was imitating it? Okay. So you did change it based on thinking that I was imitating it. Okay, so that's fine. Then I brought in a new sound, and then you all started laughing.
I think that, well, I don't know. I know I started laughing.
Well, and you started laughing, and I moved on to try to imitate him, so then I stopped. So it was
now I was trying to imitate you.
Wait, so you changed, though, without being imitated. Right?
That's true, so I fucked up.
Okay.
Okay, no, that's a good point. I fucked up. Because I changed to imitating you because nobody was imitating me. And I should have waited for somebody to imitate me or I should have stopped.
You could change if nobody was imitating
you. Yeah, I thought you could too.
I think that's okay.
See, that's what he's. One, that was my question.
If a player initiates an idea and nobody chooses. This is Ben's thing, so I don't know it as well as mine. But if a player initiates an idea and nobody chooses to imitate them, then it's objectively chosen time restriction sets by thinking something like, hey, I've been doing this too long, and as far as I can tell, no one's imitating me. They must either continue with that idea until somebody does imitate them, or stop.
Yeah.
Man.
But you didn't fuck up because he imitated you, and then you changed because he was imitating you. I fucked up because I changed to imitate Margaret.
Well, then no one was imitating me, and I started trying to imitate him.
Ah, okay.
Doesn't this quickly count everyone out?
Yeah.
It depends about whether you start out as an imitator or not.
So, one will have a longer life if they're an imitator?
Yeah.
Well, isn't the way it works?
Oh my god, that is so meta.
But if everybody ends up doing their own thing, then it just goes on.
Then you can stay within that other thing indefinitely, right?
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's interesting. God, I love this series of games.
Okay, so should we try that one again?
Yeah.
Switch back to the piano. Okay. Are we ready? Are you ready?
Mm-hmm.
You ready? Nobody wants to be the one imitated. Because we're all afraid we'll get stuck. Okay, fine.
Thank you.
first, then you caught on right away, and you started imitating her at first too, right?
I was alone
no.
with anything.
I wasn't imitating, no.
Okay, well at any rate, this is the way I heard it. You started playing, I imitated you, then you changed, so I imitated you. Then you changed, so I started imitating Allie again. Then you changed it by making it more complex, and then I started jumping around in the octaves, which is what you were doing.
The thing to do is like make it more complex, make it harder to follow each other. That's fun.
Yeah. And then I forget what I did after that. Either decided that somehow or another something went on so that I ended up switching to you, and then I started going in honor of you, kind of just going a little bit of wiggling of your hips, which is the easiest thing for you to imitate.
But I decided you weren't doing a very good job.
Right, exactly. Right, exactly. So then I thought, okay, so she's deciding that I'm not imitating her correctly, at which case I gave up. I think by then you'd already stopped. So then we all stopped. That's roughly how it went, right? I like the way that worked.
That was fun.
See, because then, but you weren't really imitating me directly, but I interpreted it as you imitating me. Because you were matching something I was doing pretty precise.
One of the times I was imitating you directly.
Okay. Well, no, but there was like one time where you weren't. It was like, oh.
Yeah.
But it was like matching up, like every time I repeated the phrase or whatever.
Uh-huh.
You ended up doing the same exact thing, so I was like...
Well, maybe there was a kind of feedback loop going on between the three of us.
Yeah, because
I
was trying to...
You were imitating me for a while,
yeah.
And
okay.
That.
Okay. All right.
That was fun.
So, we could move on to one of the new ones that hasn't been tried yet.
Did Stuart say he was coming over today, or no?
No, he said he had a potluck, remember?
Oh, yeah.
So, the potluck that you and I weren't invited to?
No, I think you're invited. It's Sarah Meister's going away.
We weren't invited.
Well, if we were invited, nobody told us we were invited.
We didn't know about it.
It might be her.